Hello, everyone. All righty. It's Friday morning, which means everyone's like ready to leave, right? But if I could just keep you here for a few minutes, that wouldn't be so bad, right? All right, so we're going to talk a little bit about smart contract hacking. And of course, smart contracts came around because Ethereum came around. So, you know, in the early days, there was Bitcoin. That's great. It's been around in 10 years or so. But you couldn't really do much with it. It was just a form of money. And you can argue that it's still not really anything you could do much with. It's incredibly volatile, and it's getting very expensive transaction-wise. So along came this other idea around 2014 of having a blockchain that you could actually do something with. So rather than just have transactions of money, Ethereum was born to allow you to actually rent time on a machine, on a global virtual machine, to maintain state, to allow transaction flow and programming languages and accounts. So all of a sudden, you had this machine where you can do much more than just move money around. You can actually have a form of like intelligence make decisions. So when you have something that's Turing complete, you know, it can do everything that a computer can do, of course, it unleashes a lot more power. So when you have a lot of power, obviously, you want to do something really important with it. So I was very impressed that this is what people chose to do with Ethereum. But so I bring this up for a reason, because about a little over a year ago, this game caught fire and actually slowed down the Ethereum blockchain to the point where it started behaving like Bitcoin. It was so sluggish. At one point, one of these little digital beanie babies sold for $100,000, just to show you that you could literally sell anything to anybody. But something interesting did come out of this idea. Because these aren't real, they don't actually do anything, we came up with this idea of a token that can be used to represent something else. So now we might see Ethereum start to be used to sell like software contracts or licenses or things like that. So they're not real, but they have value. So some good might have come out of this mess of a game. But the idea of smart contracts. So smart contracts, they allow for autonomous decisions to be made, for good or bad. Once you unleash them, they can't be changed. So I don't know if anyone here has any hacking experience with code, but you know, when was the last time you did an ethical hack and you were like, wow, that was beautiful, I loved it. Here, stamp of approval on the report. You know, that just doesn't happen. And that's with normal code that then you can go and change. Well, once something goes up on the blockchain, it's there forever. So that of course, introduces all new sorts of problems. Sure, you could point to newer versions, but your ugly mistakes will live there forever. So smart contracts, when written properly, can do some amazing things. You'll hear some examples where people say, hey, we can have Uber without Uber. You know, you can have smart contracts negotiate cheap rides and do things like that, or Airbnb without Airbnb. So I guess you're seeing a pattern here. The idea of smart contracts is to remove people whenever possible. That's good in theory, but when you have a security flaw and things move at the speed of machines, you can see a whole lot of money vanish very, very quickly. So it's really, really important to take a close look at this code before you unleash it in the world. And there's millions of reasons to take a look at this code, literally millions of reasons. The first big smart contract hack, the DAO, a couple years ago, and we're going to look at the flaw in a minute that caused that. Basically, within a matter of minutes, 3.6 million Ether were moved because of a very simple coding flaw. Now, if that happened today, it would be about $500 million hack, you know, depending on the value of ETH. Right now, ETH's kind of down. There are times when ETH was higher that this would have been a $2 billion hack, et cetera. So it's not too often that you encounter one little coding flaw that can lose billions of dollars, right? That's just not something you see every day. So it's super important to be aware that these things move at the speed of light, and we're, you know, just humans. So once the mistake's made, it might be too late to catch it. Luckily, we are looking at some technologies for detecting anomalies on the blockchain, even if they're 0 days. And then later on, we're going to talk about the parity flaw too, which also led to a big financial loss. So how bad is it? I mean, the problem really isn't going away. So a study was done of about almost a million smart contracts, believe it or not. 970,000 smart contracts were analyzed using a tool we're going to talk about in a second. And they found that 34,000 of them had critical vulnerabilities that would lead to stealing of money or preventing money from going out. That's a lot. And these are very, very serious vulnerabilities, too. They're suicidal vulnerabilities, which means the contract to be killed by anyone. So all that money's gone. prodigal vulnerabilities, which mean money can be sent to anyone, which is definitely not what you want in a smart contract. And then greedy, which means that it'll take money. So dangerous stuff. So Solidity is the language used. It was decided on by, I guess, consensus, you could say. It beat out some other languages. I wish I could stand up here and tell you that Solidity is the most beautiful thing I've ever seen, but it's far from it. It was designed to be familiar looking to people who had some experience in programming before, but unfortunately, the limitations of early Ethereum made Solidity be kind of a messy language. It's really, really sensitive. It has an order of operations that is so strict that if you make a mistake, really bad things can happen. But Solidity, it's in demand. If you know Solidity, I promise you, there's a few, you know, dozen jobs waiting for you, like tomorrow. If you look on LinkedIn, they're there. There's only a handful of folks who really understand the security implications of Solidity. So whenever you're working on an ethical hack of this kind of thing, you wanna look at it in code form early. You know, you wanna get in before it's on the blockchain and it's too late, so to speak. You can get it back, but it's better to get the Sol files first, the Solidity files. So normally the flow is you take those files, you put them up in bytecode, and they go to the blockchain. You compile them to go up. So when you look at the raw Solidity code, I like to use Atom because it has those two plugins that let you see the color highlighting. I don't know if it's that easy to see with the projector, but you can actually quickly see what's a value, what's a function, and makes that easier to work with. You can also use like browser-based ones, but I like to use Atom for that reason. So I'll start to take a look at the code and see if there's any glaring mistakes. There are some tools. They're actually getting surprisingly powerful too. Oente, this is the first one that ever came out, and the guys that wrote this ended up writing that other tool that found those flaws in the 970,000 that we're going to look at in a second. So this looks at seven vulnerabilities. One of them isn't really a vulnerability anymore, and I'll show you why in a bit. But what's great about this is now it has less than 10% false positives, which is pretty good for a tool. So once it finds one of these vulnerabilities, it's pretty accurate. The other thing is it finally lets you see what line of code the vulnerability is on. When this first came out, it didn't do that. So it would tell you, hey, you have the DAO vulnerability, reentrancy. And it's like, that's great, but this contract's like 600 lines long. Where is it? Like, you're not giving me enough to go on. Now it'll actually show you the line, for better or worse, because I think it's getting a little too easy for script kiddies now to start getting into Ethereum. And Manticore is still developing, but I think it's going to quickly catch up in popularity. So Mayan is the tool that was used for that study. Again, it evolved from Oente, really. It checks for prodigal, suicidal, and greedy that I introduced earlier. Now, what's really dangerous about this is it doesn't just show you the line that the vulnerability is on. It actually shows you what to inject to exploit the vulnerability. So this is incredibly disastrous if this falls into the wrong hands, right? It's out there freely. So if someone plays around with it a little bit, gets it running, and it could be temperamental. But if you get it running, usually by just downloading like a Docker with it already running on there, you're able to not only find vulnerabilities, but instantly exploit them. So it's only a matter of time before you hear about someone getting away with a few million dollars, and the reason is they just spent 5 minutes learning how to run this tool. It's cool that it's out there, but it's a little dangerous that it's out there too. So normally when I'm doing one of these things, I'll actually talk to the developers first. I know with normal ethical hacking, everyone's like, oh, I don't want to talk to any developers. They all think their code's so special. It's really not. In this case, you can learn some interesting things. So I like to talk to them and see what they intended, because sometimes what they wrote is not really what they intended to write. So I'll look at the Sol file, if I have some mistakes, I'll try compiling it. If there's a mistake there, well, then I know I've got other issues they have to work on. I'll dissect the code flow, run Oente. I put cross fingers as a joke because it's so temperamental. If you update the Z3 theorem prover, sometimes it'll break. So I like to commit Dockers with it running, so I always have it in like a sterile state. I'll run Manticore, run Mayan. So a lot of times those will give you those low-hanging fruits. And in this case, low-hanging fruit isn't, hey, you have a cookie that's insecure. No, in this case, it's, hey, you just lost all like everything. So the low-hanging fruit's pretty significant. And then I'll manually check. So we're going to go through some of these vulnerabilities, and also we're going to talk a little bit about writing smart contracts to attack smart contracts. Obviously, I can't sit here and teach Solidity. That just can't be done in this time period, but I'll show the concepts that you could work on if you wish, and you could bother me on line if you want. So first reentrancy. This is the most famous vulnerability, the one that owned the DAO. Rather than put all the DAO code up, I just wrote a very simple version of the program. So basically what happens is, because Solidity is read in order and it's so dependent on the order, if you do the accounting after something happens, the program can be tricked. So in line 7, that is where the money is sent for some reason. Like, let's say you're withdrawing before an investment or whatever. You're making some kind of business logic and taking money out. But the accounting is actually zeroed out on line 8. So as a result, if you're able to attack this contract, you can get all the money out repeatedly from line 7 before it even does any kind of accounting. So I'm going to show you the mind-blowing fix that would have saved, you know, at the time, you know, 3.6 million Ether. So watch 7 and 8 very carefully, and that's really it. You just switch them. The world's simplest code fix. Just move one line up, and all of a sudden, millions of dollars are safe. You're not going to encounter that in most other programming languages, which is why Solidity is still not ideal. So if anyone comes up with a better version, you know, for smart contracts, please let me know. Because of that design, that flaw, you can see that there needs to be a way for someone to quickly get that money out, or otherwise the account owner will notice something's happening. So to do it manually would be really, really difficult. I don't think you can get anything significant done that way. However, the attacker probably didn't do it manually. So what I would do if I saw this is I'd write a contract to attack a contract like I just did. So I call it contract attack, you know, really creative name. And basically what it does is it imports the contract you just saw, the vulnerable one, and it creates its own variable, R, and it makes it the type of a contract value, which you could do in Solidity. So it's actually named after the other contract, reentrancy. So what this program does when it runs along is it starts to run the function steal, and on line 14, it tries to take tokens from the other account. Fine, it does it once. After it does that, though, it then goes down to a fallback function, which has like a little iterative timer of sorts in it. And then it will try and continue to run this over and over again to keep getting the money out automatically. And then you could set a number depending on the gas that's used, and we'll talk about gas in a second. So that'll prevent it from running and exhausting itself and actually backfiring and sending all the money back. So you would have to figure out how much you can get out, what's expected to be in there. So in this case, I put 1,000. It'll run it 1,000 times, which would be 1,000 ETH, which is pretty good. Not a bad haul, you know. But you can change that as needed. So with just such a simple few lines of code, you can have the power of automation attack something that's running on automation. No humans are involved, and in a few moments, all that money's gone. So I'm actually going to be working on a new talk soon where I show all the types of contracts you could write to attack contracts. But I just wanted to introduce this general idea because no one's really talking about this. It's a very different world. It's sort of like scripting, except you're using the power of the Ethereum virtual machine against itself. So in the DAO, it's really funny because the original line had a comment that said, be nice and get his rewards. And of course, the person who took advantage of this really did get his rewards because he's sitting on 3.6 million Ether and was never caught. It led to a whole fork and everything and a whole political battle inside Ethereum. So just remember, the simplest little line, you know, can cause such a major problem. So that's why it's worth pointing that out. There are other really simple mistakes that you can make in Ethereum that can cause big problems. So one was the parity wallet hack, the first one. There's two parity attacks we're going to look at. So functions have visibilities in Solidity, and they could be internal, external, public, private. If you do not declare one, unfortunately, it's just automatically made public. I guess the design idea there was if you don't declare it, it becomes public, so that way the program can still do something. That's probably the thinking that was behind it. Now, the person that wrote this, Gavin Wood, is one of the founders of, one of the creators of Solidity. So he should have known better. When they wrote this, they forgot to claim that it should be internal. So the original pink line there didn't have that declaration. So as a result, this wallet, this parity wallet, was public, which means anyone can make requests to it, anyone can then effectively own it, and that's exactly what happened. So with a very simple two-step attack, someone was able to run init wallet and literally just say to the contract, hey, you belong to me now. That's it, one request, and it belonged to that person. So once the wallet belongs to the person, obviously the best thing to do is then send money somewhere else. And that's exactly what he did, and he started doing it. And he was able to get about $32 million for his efforts because there were some ICOs going on and the wallets that he went after had a lot of money in them. Now, at the same time, this group called the White Hat Hacking Group, they saw this was going on because this wasn't done by contract. This was a person manually doing it. They were able to step in and, in a race against time, start stealing money from other wallets, stealing in quotes, just to keep them safe until the patch could be deployed. And then they return the money, which is nice, because if the White Hat Hacking Group didn't return the money, they would really need to come up with a different name. You know, that wouldn't work anymore. So, but it was a race against time. In this case, it wasn't contracts, it was humans doing it. So parity, poor parity, was not done being owned yet. So unfortunately, it was written with a huge, huge, huge mistake. All the multi-sig wallets, multi-sig is a good thing, you know, multi-sig anywhere in security is a good thing. Unfortunately, they all shared one library, which was just a modified wallet code. Instead of being stateless, it was an actual wallet code that could be attacked, and attacked it was. So because they all shared it, someone accidentally was able to attack it. So that's the comment that DevOps 199 meant. He accidentally killed the wallet. Now, what that means is about 500,000 ETH were locked away forever. So that's not really a great thing to have happen. We still haven't recovered them, they're gone. Now, let's define the term accident. Do you ever do two things in a row in accident? Probably not, right? Like, you know, you don't like accidentally run up a flight of stairs and throw an axe through a door. You know, like, it's just a very weird concept. So that's sort of like an analogy to what happened here. Two really unlikely things happen back to back. So he claims that he accidentally tried to kill the contract in the init wallet by doing two steps, by trying to own it and kill it. So to claim that those two things just accidentally happen is a bit of a stretch. So I'm not sure why he's, you know, not behind bars, honestly. But and if you look at the history, you've seen that this guy's actually done some other poking around contracts too. So all this was because they decided to share. They got lazy and shared one non-stateless library. So it's a really, really bad mistake to make. So overflows and underflows. In regular coding, you have buffer overflows, things like that. Solidity is really, really temperamental with this sort of thing. If your number gets too big, it's sort of, you could think of it as like an odometer in a classic car. So I like classic cars. I'm pretty tall. I don't really fit in new ones. But classic car, if you have 99,999 miles on the odometer, what happens when you go one more mile? It goes to zero. And that is exactly what happens in Solidity. If your number is too large and you're not using something like the safe math library from Open Zeppelin, it will all of a sudden wipe everything out. So you got to be careful with math if you're not using that library, or just use the library. But the other thing is even more interesting. If you could somehow manually crank back an odometer, what happens? You go from zero to 99,999, right? The same thing happens in Solidity. If you're not careful, you could decrement, and you can end up with all the money. That's a pretty great function to have, right? You know, spend a little money and then get all the money. That's not really what you want. So you definitely want to try and implement safe math libraries to avoid problems like that. So in the early days of Ethereum, people used it at first to experiment with games and things like that. I don't know if anyone's familiar with the concept of chain letters. They're pretty old. The idea was you'd send a letter and say, hey, send a dollar to each of these five people and then mail it on. And that would go on and on. And the idea was you'd get all this money. And of course, no one ever got any money. They just kept whatever they got in the mail. So they tried to do something like that in like a Ponzi scheme. And you see the word Ponzi in Ethereum all the time. People who experiment, back when Ethereum was worth nothing, even less than it's worth now, before the big bubble burst there, you would have a game set up like where you would put in one ether, let's say, which wasn't really worth much. And then the game would go that you would remain king of the ether until someone put in 1.5 ETH, and then they became the king of the ether because that money got paid to you. Then the next person would put two, and they'd become king of the ether, and the money would get paid to the next person. So that's a good idea in theory, I guess, if you just want to play around with the technology. But what would happen is, if you had a contract run not by a human, but but owned by an account, without enough gas present, the contract could fail, which means you could become king of the ether without that money being paid to the person who actually deserved it. So just to simplify right here, so if you have a system set up where the compensation has to be sent, and it automatically says compensation sent true, it's sort of like reentrancy. It just, the Solidity just reads and says, okay, everything's good, the money was sent, it's all fine. What you really want to do is something like a line before. You want to have something throw if a mistake happens. So if there is an external contract that fails because there wasn't enough gas present, then the entire thing will die and people won't lose what they're entitled to. So gas is an important concept to understand. Right now, you can use this ETH stat site that lets you know how much gas limit is in a block. And blocks have gas limits, see? So you could think of a Jeep as like a block, right? If you keep trying to put gas in, that's what happens. So it's the same with Ethereum. You just can't keep putting gas in. So you have to check what the limits are and work around them. So it's important to understand that. And that's the last car analogy, no more cars. So another thing that could happen is you want to try and do a withdraw, not send. So rather like a pull than push. This also is a safer way to handle that kind of issue. So when you're doing a withdraw, not send, over here, again, you can make a mistake. You can have it die and not actually send the money to anybody. But if you create a whole proper withdraw system and you fool it, then only your contract will fail and not the whole thing. So money won't be taken away from other folks. It'll just die for you, and then it's over. So whenever you're working with gas, it has to be always flagged that you're making sure there's enough there to run the contract properly. It's interesting, because of this sort of line, this line-by-line structure of Solidity, we see that the transaction order dependence becomes a problem. So you could create a game like this, a puzzle game, and what you could do is you could set up a puzzle where people have to make guesses. It really doesn't matter what it is, just for illustration. So you could start the puzzle on the left there, and on the right you could create the function that actually takes people's guesses. Now, what's interesting is early in the row of functions that you're reading here, someone could be observing on the blockchain that guesses are being made, that action's happening, that people are failing, not getting it right, et cetera. Excitement can build. You know, everyone could be like, ooh, this game is so cool, I hope I'm the one that gets the big payout. But while that's going on, the owner can sit there and wait to see when it's getting close to being a win, and then at the very last minute, he can change what the reward is. So because people are trusting the flow and the order, they can be putting money in or making guesses or whatever, and then at the last minute, he could just be like, well, I'm only going to reward one ETH if you win, not 5,000 or whatever. You know? So you're allowed to change at the very end. And because of the order of transactions that come in, there's a very good chance you'll succeed in beating the guesses to actually not pay out what you promised. A better way to do something like this, a fair way to do something, would be have something that's the equivalent of a sealed envelope that has the amount in it. Everyone has it already. It's out there for the world to see. And then when the game is over, that's when you can give out the key so they can open it and see they're getting paid fairly. But anytime I see a transaction or dependence get flagged, I look carefully at the code to see what is it that's happening. What is it that if there's any kind of time drift, are we going to have a problem here? You can't let time be the factor ever in one of these programs. Things happen, you know, things happen on the blockchain with transactions coming in. And you don't want a situation where someone can game a system by, I don't know, like trying to pay extra gas to get their contract in first, to have something happen illegally first. You want to make sure that it can survive the regular time drift of a blockchain. So it shouldn't be something that's so dependent on the order for fairness. It should be that the fairness is actually respected. One of the flaws that keeps getting flagged is call stack depth limit. This isn't even really a vulnerability anymore. So everyone should know, if you see this, it just means it's sloppy code, but it doesn't actually exist anymore. After EIP 150, they prevented this from happening. So what used to happen is because of 1024 depth of the call stack, as you approached it, you could have this kind of problem where it would, you know, basically blow up. So now what they did was they made it increasingly more expensive in gas when you got to 63 out of 64. Of the call stack depth, and as a result, it's not really possible for this to happen. The amount of gas you'd have to put in wouldn't be worth it for any amount of money that you get out of it. So in case you ever see that, it's not really a vulnerability anymore. So a lot of times people will publish their contracts to prove that they're being honest, but this is where the color highlighting comes in handy in Atom. So you can have variables that look very similar. You know, you can have a payout cursor ID with the underscore at the end, and then you can have one without the underscore at the end. And someone who just quickly looks at this code might just assume that's all the same thing. So in this contract, actually, they'll think that they're getting paid out, but in reality, it's going to the person without the underscore, and that could be the owner of the contract rather than the person who's executing the contract. So a lot of times, things will be hidden right in plain sight, hoping that no one will notice them. So you always have to be careful of variable function ambiguity. It's better to name things differently in case you make an honest mistake that's interpreted as a dishonest one. So some other things. Besides the order, the transaction order, just timestamp dependence in general, you don't want to see a contract that depends so much on, let's say, 60 seconds later something has to happen, because things always change on the blockchain. There can be, you know, slowdowns and things. You don't want that to happen. You want to make sure that it's dependent on something real. Business logic flaws are like one of the hardest things to still look for. Like I said, talking to developers can prevent this, because what will happen is they'll think they're coding something that they're really not, and I see that time and time again. So you want to make sure you understand what they were trying to do, see any design documents they had in mind. Encryption is a funny one to bring up. So by definition, you want to be able to see things on a blockchain, right? That's the whole point, to have that public ledger. So any kind of game or anything that's created on Solidity has a risk of people seeing people's guesses. So let's say there's only 100 guesses you can make. After the guesses start disappearing and people see all the guesses that were already made, they could come in with a reasonable chance of getting the right one. A lot of things are visible like that, not encrypted. And I will have something to say on encryption in a second, because there's something interesting coming now to Ethereum. Separating public-private data. A lot of the work I'm getting when it comes to hacking smart contracts is companies are creating their own little in-house versions of Ethereum, their own little private ones, and they're running things internally only, and then whenever that is done, they'll reach out to the greater blockchain to settle up and actually send money along or whatever. A great example of this is Quorum from JPMC, did a lot of work on that. They came up with a great way to have an internal server and a private for transaction functions. So anytime something was supposed to be private, it would make a request of this other server so that private piece of information could be sent to somebody or whatever. And if it accidentally ever got into a world, it means nothing, because it was just a hash that pointed to an internal server. So whenever you're dealing with like an internal piece of Solidity code, you have to take a look at what they're doing to separate the public and private data, because it's so amazingly easy to send embarrassing stuff out to the blockchain for the whole world to see. And like I said, once it's out forever. It's always going to be there. So we're trying to prep for the future here. Ethereum's not just supposed to be a way to run some simple code. We really like the idea of actually having a Web 3.0, a whole new decentralized internet of sorts. I got a kick out of how they handled this idea in Silicon Valley this last season. They tried to create this decentralized internet, and they even mentioned things like the 51% attack, which I thought was pretty cool. So what we're looking for here is the ability to store files on machines using something called Swarm. We finally have encryption rolling in that. So visualize it as something like a BitTorrent out there. And the only way you can actually access anything that's stored on those machines is if you have the key, the wallet key, because you're the rightful owner. The other thing you could do is, with BitTorrent, files can disappear, right? Or with IPFS, why would someone keep it on their machine forever? They'll delete it when they're done, or when the movie or song or whatever isn't hot anymore. With something like Swarm, there's micropayments that you can make in Ethereum. So in theory, you could tell all these machines on the system, hey, please keep this critical piece of encrypted information alive for 3 years, and I'll make you these micropayments if you do so. So what you can begin to see is a world where, with smart contracts and micropayments, we can safely have critical files stored that are immune to censorship, immune to someone breaking into a data center and stealing a server, because all they would get is one little tiny slice, one little shard of a file. So that's what kind of what we're working towards right now, this idea that one day maybe we can store actual websites or, you know, actual other content without things like cloud companies owning it or having any regulatory control. So I believe in a secure private internet. Now, because it's impossible for a human to always be able to catch every mistake, one other thing we're working on that's pretty cool right now is real-time blockchain protection. So I'm experimenting with AI right now that lets us see what a smart contract's supposed to look like, literally look like, using the visualizations. And then if any anomalies appear, anything looks unusual at a glance, the system will be able to say, hey, something's happening. So it doesn't even have to be a known thing like reentrancy or something like that. It could be a true zero day that for some reason money is moving quickly in an unexpected pattern and we could spot it. So this is what I want to see happening now in the industry, because like I said, once one of these attacks runs rampant, it runs rampant really, really quickly. So it's pretty easy to get involved. Just master Solidity. Done, right? That's it? Okay. So basically, it's becoming pretty easy to get on board here. There's smart contract hacking challenges online you could participate in. They kind of let you experiment, see if you find the vulnerabilities, and then check your work after. I think that's great. You'll notice the coin price craze is over, right? No one cares anymore what the value of Bitcoin is any given day. For a while, that's all anyone did. They woke up, they're like, what's Bitcoin today? What's ETH today? You know, that's all it was. And that was the entirety of blockchain. Now that that's done and everything's kind of like calmed down, we can actually start doing practical things with the technology, and that's what you're starting to see. You're starting to see distributed applications being written. You're starting to see actual work being done, which is why the Enterprise Ethereum Alliance exists. That's a great place. Those companies, there's like 250 of them. They're really big companies too. They're not mom and pop shops. They're like, you know, BP, the oil company, or, you know, like they're really, really big companies. And they're trying to do creative things with Ethereum. So it's a good time to get started. And of course, it's like shooting fish in a barrel as far as finding customers, because once you get good at hacking Solidity, they're obviously going to need folks to do it. All right, so I guess I kind of had plenty of coffee and moved at a pretty zippy pace. So there's time for questions if anyone has them this early in the morning. I chose to not drink last night, even though it's RSA week. So here I am, all super hyper. Yesterday morning I gave a talk too, and everyone was really dead because it was, you know, Pitbull was the night before and everyone was so like destroyed. I was more excited to see Paris Hilton because I wanted to see where my money goes all these years as a Hilton Diamond member. And there she is. She gets all the money. So that was very entertaining. So if anyone has a question, you can ask now or you can try and spot me in the hallway. I'm very hard to spot. I blend right in.
Besides Solidity, did you do research on other smart contract language? Do you see anything significantly better than this?
Well, better is a funny word, right? Because, yeah, so the other ones will claim to be better, the newer, whatever. The only problem is anyone using them, you know? This is the same kind of problem with, like, post-quantum crypto. Ethereum is moving towards post-quantum crypto, for example, but there is actually a blockchain that's post-quantum safe. But no one uses it for anything. So what? Zcash, for example, is a coin that is private, right? So it's used for private transactions, but no one's using it. So what's cool is when stuff like that gets implemented because it's such an open community. So I believe in Ethereum still. So I'm happy that now the ZK snarks, for example, are allowing for private transactions to be worked with. So soon, Ethereum will have that functionality that as a mainstream. I'm a little worried, though, also, because what's going to happen the minute Ethereum goes private, for example, with transaction is all the headlines are going to be dark web money. You know, it's going to turn into like a PR nightmare for a little while. But anytime I see an interesting security technology appear, something more secure in another contract language, I just kind of like wait around for it to be absorbed. I think Ethereum's at the cutting edge when it comes to that too. Because look at like Bitcoin. Essentially, you still can't really do anything with it, and it still has huge future vulnerabilities. It's not future-proof at all. So I like to see how with Ethereum, every time there's a new release, we get something for it. We're moving towards proof of stake. We're moving towards other things. So for now, we're still stuck with Solidity. But every once in a while, when there's a major enough vulnerability, we come up with some kind of workaround for it, and then we plot on. But yeah, I'd like to see some new language come out. I think that would be neat. That's not yet. Oh boy, we're gonna have a back
so
and forth here.
I may follow up. So if you look at Solidity, their version is still like 0.4 or something. So what do they think? I mean, are they thinking they're still working on it?
Yeah, absolutely.
It should not be used for any serious money transfer yet.
What's in a version number, right? There's a great example of this just a couple of days ago. I don't know how into Linux you are, but all of a sudden now we're at 5.0, right? Like, ooh, so Linus is like, don't get excited. Why is the kernel 5.0? because I got tired of, I ran out of fingers and toes, he said, counting up to 4.2. You know, like, so what's an aversion number, right? You like to think that it has that philosophical idea of 1.0 means it's so great and beautiful, but you know, there's gonna be just as many vulnerabilities in 1.0. So I wouldn't get too hung up on that. It's a whole version thing. So anyone else have a question? No? It's okay, don't be shy. The minute I say that, people get more shy, that's all right. It's okay, but yeah, if not, feel free to come have a chat with me. I'm very friendly, I promise. And thanks for coming this early. I appreciate it. Thank you.